Hey, this is Pastor Purple. I'm with Pastor Enrico from the Netherlands, and we are on the study tour, as you know, and so I thought it would be really cool if I could capture one person other than me saying something about how interesting they found it. And one thing I have noticed is that the past couple of days, Enrico has been bouncing along a bit too happy about the information we found out, culminating in us being in Armageddon. So I figure he might be the person to start with. So tell me, what was your favorite bit about today, I think?
Well, we visited quite a number of sites. We visited Armageddon, the city of Megiddo, and we even had a look at the valley in which Revelation 16 talks about a cataclysmic battle ending all evil and everything that we know of. But the highlight, absolute highlight for me, was when we went to Mount Carmel. 1 Kings 18, I believe, talks about that story in which Elijah proved to the people there who the true and living God was by letting fire come on wood that was had been made wet. And afterwards, well, that's the other side of the story. He slaughtered quite a few Baal priests. Then having
450, can I just say? Yeah, that's quite serious, because I was like, if you're going to be a prophet, you actually have to be prepared to kill 450 men.
Yeah, that was, like, what's that? Yes, that's an interesting part of the story. But being on Mount Carmel itself, the mountain itself, having a view, tasting of the air, gives you quite a good idea why Elijah chose that specific bit and there and to stand there, because of the height, everybody could see it happen. Those that did not climb up the mountain, because it was on such a height that even from downstairs you could see what was happening upstairs. And also, the thanks to the height, he was symbolically closer to God. So being there on that mountain was very special. I had my God experience there, and it was a big blessing.
Awesome. Yes, he bounced quite a lot, I think. He said I wasn't allowed to giggle. Not gonna happen.
No, we don't giggle.
No. Especially because at one point we were going to see his favorite rabbi. And in order to do that, we had to climb into some graves.
Yes. We visited graveyards, or maybe tombs is a better word, of big names amongst rabbis. We saw the tomb of Gamaliel and the tomb of his son and his daughter, which is a big name in rabbinic Judaism.
Yeah.
And we saw a lot more ancient tombs of how the big names and how influential people and rabbis were buried. So that also was quite a good experience.
Why is, now forgive me, Gamaliel?
Gamaliel.
Gamaliel.
Yes.
See, learning Dutch and Hebrew at the same time is just awesome. Why do you like him the most?
Well, we can't prove anything, and it's probably not the case, but
maybe there is
very small chance that the tomb of Gamaliel that we saw today might be the Gamaliel that we encounter in the book of Acts, when Peter and the other disciple got arrested. And then the Sanhedrin was deciding what to do with their lives. And then suddenly Gamaliel, a Pharisee among the rabbis, stood up and he said, well, just let them go, because if this is not of God, it will slowly die out, this movement of this Jesus movement. If it is of God, you might find yourself fighting against God himself. So that's why the name, at least,
strikes a chord.
Is
there, as you're telling the story, I think there seems to be, to me, a natural lesson coming out for people who are watching today, and certainly for me. What would you impart from that story next? What kind of lesson do you think there is to be?
Well, I think there's a lesson there for all of us. You should give the unknown, unexpected, the new, the challenging, a chance to let it prove to be either of God or not of God, instead of instantly battling something that's either odd, strange, new, or unfamiliar, mm-hmm. because the Jesus movement that Peter was so powerfully sharing was quite unfamiliar for the Sanhedrin mm-hmm. and the Jews of that time.
Yeah.
So Gamaliel the wise, he sometimes referred to, stood up and said, "You know what? We're not going to battle this. Let it go. We're going to see what happens with it. If it is of God, we might find ourselves. We're taking a risk of fighting God Himself. Mm-hmm. But in the case it's not of God, it will probably die out." So there's a good lesson there for us here, living in the present time. Mm-hmm. Sometimes it's good not to instantly stand up and challenge every single new idea or anything that's strange to you.
Yeah, well, I have a lot of creative people who follow me, so they'll be very pleased to hear that, I think. Bit of an encouragement along their way. Don't worry, we won't try and snuff you out immediately and just burn your idea.
We're just going to wait and see if it's of God. And if not, we're going to wait and see how it dies out.
Yeah, because we don't have to kill it.
No.
I guess.
Remember, no giggling. We don't giggle.
Okay. Straight face.
Yes.
Clearly.
Pastors don't smile.
No. Serious. Is there anything else that you'd like to share with us today?
Yes. It was a very busy day. Yes. And it's time to rest because tomorrow we have another round.
Oh my gosh, right?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. So I'm a little bit tired. And we're going to go for tonight to bed. Thank you so much for watching. And we hope that you have really understood that the Jesus thing hasn't died out. We're still here talking about it today. He still lives. He's still giving life to people's situations. Mm-hmm. And as Pastor Enrico says, you know, don't jump on everything that you think immediately is so different that it frightens you. Actually give it a chance to see what God will do with it. Have a great evening. See ya.
Bye. See ya.